Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. It's Friday, so we're back to our routine of Q&A. I'm asking questions submitted by listeners to the director of the Center for Health Security at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, Dr. Tom Inglesby. Let's listen. Dr. Inglesby, thank you so much for joining me to answer listener questions on the podcast.
Thanks for having me, Josh.
So my first question is why the United States has had such a harder time with the virus than Europe. You may have seen this figure that's circulating on the internet showing the curves look pretty different. The United States still seeing quite a large number of cases and deaths, and Europe seeing far fewer. Why do you think that's the case?
Well, I don't think we know for sure. I don't think there have been large studies that really have isolated particular differences, but I think it's reasonable to say that Europe has, or many places in Europe, opened up more slowly, not all, but many, than many places in the United States. I think at a general level, there has been good partnership between public health agencies and governments in Europe. And I think we've had some more differences, substantive differences here in the United States. I think, for example, the discussions about face coverings and, you know, the fact that many people are choosing not to do that or to listen to guidance around mass gatherings, I think is an increased risk. And I think also one of the more important factors, I probably should have started with this, is just the difference in diagnostic testing from the very beginning. We were very slow to be able to transition from small-scale diagnostic testing to wide-scale. That did not go well. And I think in many other places in the world, they had a smoother transition. So I think it's many reasons. And unfortunately, hopefully we can fix some of them going forward.
Let me ask you about one factor, contact tracing. There's a story about Germany doing contact tracing well. Do you think that the response to cases has been more robust in Europe than the United States, or is that hard to generalize?
It's probably hard to generalize, but I think it is fair to say that public health agencies in other countries have more connection to clinical systems, to healthcare systems, and in many places, the power to do contact tracing was already in a ministry of health or a local health department. And in the United States, we're having to build that up. So I think it's a difference in terms of our baseline ability to do public health.
So let me ask you another question about contact tracing. There are some stories saying it's working, like Hawaii has been very successful in part because of contact tracing. There are other stories saying maybe it isn't working. There was recently a story about New York City having some challenges. How do you put this together?
Yeah, well, first of all, in terms of an activity, there's no doubt that contact tracing works. We've seen it work in different parts of the world. We know it works for other diseases, and it will work if implemented well and at the right scale for this disease. It will help. It may not be a perfect solution, but it will absolutely help us move in the right direction. I think in terms of specific examples of contact tracing, Hawaii has been focused very hard from the beginning, both around their isolation of travelers and having people quarantine, self-quarantine, and also contact tracing. And they've also had much lower numbers. So it is possible to do contact tracing well at lower numbers than it is to do it well at very high numbers. And some states obviously still have hundreds or thousands of new cases every day. And that is extraordinary pressure on a contact tracing program. New York City, there was a critical article about it 2 days ago about number of people whose phone numbers couldn't be found or otherwise, you know, who didn't complete an interview. And I think I got a briefing about that program yesterday, and I actually was impressed by the scale of the effort. There are 3,000 people in New York City working on contact tracing, 500 of whom are going to local neighborhoods, you know, talking to people, trying to get to people's into people's lives. And they are doing specific metrics. They're publishing their metrics and are trying to improve each one every week. I do think that kind of transparency is going to be really important for contact tracing programs around the country.
So it's really about the implementation.
Yes, exactly.
So in the United States, we've seen some stories about harassment of public health officials. I think there was one story saying 27 public health officials have resigned or been pushed out or faced harassment. What do you make of these threats?
I think it should be seen as a national scandal. I mean, these are the people that are trying to help us figure out our way out of a pandemic and are probably working 24/7 with their teams to figure out how to expand diagnostic testing, set up contact tracing, get to underserved people, give out guidance that will help us diminish our risks. And in turn, they're getting threats. They're getting, harassment from social media or by other means. And what's most scandalous about it is they don't seem to have the support of their political leadership. And that is the job number one of a political leader who's got appointees who are doing difficult work. How can they do their job if they don't have the support of their own bosses? So I think that's particularly shameful. And hopefully, especially as it looks like parts of the country are now moving into more difficult phases of this pandemic again, leadership will understand the importance of having strong public health officials in those roles and will not let them be attacked without their support.
And it's sort of a early indicator of a response that's not going to be successful if people are really attacking the public health leader without the public health leader getting strong support.
Absolutely. It's terrible.
So I want to ask about one of these areas where there's been some conflict, which has to do with masking and the issue of mask ordinances. But one question we got from a listener is there evidence that wearing masks while outside works?
So first of all, the evidence of indoor transmission versus outdoor transmission is it's growing over time. Like, we're learning more about the different differential risks between the two. And it's very clear that indoor risk is much, much higher than outdoors. But there is outdoor transmission that does occur at a lower level. And so when around someone at close contact, face mask will decrease risks in the same way or in some way similar to indoor protection. I mean, we know there is more air movement, so there is overall less risk, but still covering face is still a way for us to lower the burden of virus that we might be inadvertently, unknowingly expiring into the air. So at close contact, certainly if people are involved, for example, in an outdoor protest or demonstration, they should certainly be wearing cloth face coverings. And if they're in other settings where they can't keep at least 6 feet or more away from other people, they should certainly be wearing a mask.
Great. Here's a question. Someone says, I don't have symptoms, but I do want to get tested. Should I quarantine myself after I get tested until I get the answer?
I think if you don't have symptoms, then you shouldn't quarantine yourself unless you have had a very compelling reason. An
exposure, for example.
If you had an exposure, a very close exposure, someone in your household or a very close coworker, and you believe that you have a high chance of having been infected, then that would be reasonable for you to wait for the results of those tests and to take yourself out of circulation and stay at home. But if you've absolutely no reason to have been, if you've no known exposure and you just feel like getting tested, I think that's fine at this point. Testing is available and you should get tested if you believe you want to get tested. And if you had no particular reason to do that test, you had no exposure, then I don't think you need to stay in quarantine. But if you were, for example, if you were, you know, you had your spouse or your child was just diagnosed with COVID, you don't have any symptoms, I think it's reasonable to stay at home until you test.
Well, in that case, you might be quarantined for 14 days.
You definitely would be quarantined for 14 days, but it's certainly quarantined. Yeah, either way, you're home, right? Whether you have a positive test or not.
So the testing itself maybe doesn't mean do it, but if there is an exposure, you would need.
Exactly.
A listener asks, can COVID-19 virus be killed by freezing my wallet and credit cards in my household freezer. I guess they're imagining that they go out, they use the credit card, they want to make sure that it's safe. Should they stick it in the freezer when they get home?
So, yeah, we know that COVID can survive in a freezer for a period of time, and especially if it was in some place that was a little protected. Not everything is going to be frozen in the same way in a wallet. I would not count on a freezer being a disinfectant itself. I think you just need to continue to do hand sanitizer. You need to wash your hands when you use high touch things like wallets or credit cards. And I don't think there's a lot of evidence for that as a strategy.
Okay. Well, that's good news for freezers. Scientists, here's a question, are saying that this virus will not be around for a long time. Oh, sorry, will be around for a long time. And that even with the vaccine, life won't go back to normal. Is that true? Is that really true that life won't go back to normal even if we have a vaccine?
I think that it will get better, but there will, we're not all going to get vaccinated at the same time. Let's say a vaccine comes out on, you know, pick a date, a dream come true that we start getting vaccine in January 2021 or the end of December of 2020. Some people will start to get vaccinated before others, presumably the people at highest risk, or either from their jobs or from their age or their underlying conditions. So we'll begin to start protecting parts of the population. It will probably take some time for vaccine to become available for the rest of the population. So it will start to get more normal over time as more and more people get vaccinated. There probably will be some people who decide not to get vaccinated. So this disease will still be around. This isn't a disease that will be ended by the vaccine. It will still be in the world. But the more that we have people vaccinated, the less likely there is a chance of an outbreak in any given community. And once people are vaccinated, depending on how effective the vaccine is, then many of them, or hopefully most, or close to as many as we can get, close to as 100% as we can get, will be protected. Some vaccines are 60% effective. Some vaccines are closer to high 90s. So it will all depend on the vaccine itself and when people are vaccinated.
So it may not be just flipping off the light on COVID. It might be more of a dimmer as we get vaccination, as it gets better.
I think it'll be a lot better over time. It won't happen overnight and it won't be completely gone, but it'll be something that we can learn to live easier with.
Do you think people should keep a contact diary? So if they turn out to have COVID and the contact tracer calls, they know exactly who they've had close contact with.
I think they do that. In New Zealand, for example, they encourage people to have a contact diary. Not everyone does it. I don't think it's mandatory. I think if it's something that would be easy for you to do, then it's possible that in the future, if you do get exposed, that certainly people will want to know about your contacts. But I certainly don't think it's mandatory. I think it's something that people have done in various parts of the world. And if it's something that you'd like to do, there's a logic to it. But I think otherwise, contact tracers will talk you through your experiences of the last few days and help you to go through that process.
Got it. Can someone get COVID-19 from swimming in a pool, lake, or the ocean?
Unlikely from the water itself, very unlikely from a pool. It's chlorine kills the virus, and lakes or oceans are very large bodies of water, and dilution typically is plenty in any place of that size water. I think it's the activities above the water that are most concerning. It's if people are having, kind of acting as they might in a normal beach and very close together and sitting in, large gatherings that are happening at a pool or a party or a lake or an ocean. It's the transmission through the air.
The people. Yeah, it's the people. I know that you do a lot of the Sunday talk shows, Dr. Inglesby, but I appreciate that you're willing to take the really hard questions here from our listeners. So we got a couple more for you. You ready?
Yes.
How safe are public restrooms?
Yeah. Well, I think you should treat the restroom like you would treat it normally, which is, you know, basically lots of, you know, hand washing and hand sanitizer. And it's we know that transmission is typically through respiratory droplet, possibly through aerosol as a second concern, but really a close range contact. So we haven't had a lot of transmission through documented from public restrooms at this point. It's not to say it's impossible, but certainly hand hygiene will be very important. And, you know, continue to wear face coverings if you're in a public restroom and have physical spacing, just like you would in the outside, the rest of the world.
Got it. So it's not fundamentally different than any other place.
Not that we know of at this point.
And then the last question, what about elevators? Are you know, what considerations should people have for elevators?
Yeah, I mean, elevators are a little tricky because while you can wear a face covering like you can in the rest of your indoor interactions or close interactions, you can't really maintain distance from others. Typically in an elevator, it's hard to maintain that kind of space, especially if it's a small elevator or a crowded elevator. So I'd say what I typically will take the stairs, but I also think that if I need to take the elevator, it's typically a very short ride. And so it's not a prolonged interaction with others. And if you wear a face covering, then I think that will diminish your chances of transmitting the virus and hopefully some modest protection against receiving the virus. So I'd take the stairs if you can, but if you can't, I think it's a small risk.
I also have seen some recommendations for office buildings to try to stagger entry and exit times and restrict the number of people on elevators. Do you think those kinds of policy solutions are helpful?
I think they're great. If they can be implemented in a building and you can take the elevator by yourself, that would be terrific. Depends on, you know, the size of the building, though. Maybe that's not logistically possible, but if it could be staggered and you can solo ride, that'd be even better.
Great. Maybe I'll sneak in one last question for you, which is, here we are almost at July 1st. We're, you know, nearly 6 months into the virus here in the United States. You know, what do you think the major challenge for the country is as you look ahead to the summer?
I think it's finding the balance between the closure, complete closure, which we lived through, you know, March and April and parts of May, and complete reopening, which I think probably is in many places not going to go well, especially if people, you know, decide to not wear masks, not socially distance, start regathering in larger numbers. So I think for the country, finding a place in between where hopefully most businesses can operate in some way and we can have some normal interaction in our world, in our life, but also not assuming this virus has changed, just recognizing that we are in a different world for now. And that the more social interaction we have, the more close social interaction we have, the faster this virus will spread and the higher the peaks and the more quickly we'll get them. So I do think we need to find a balance or else we're going to have places which get into healthcare crisis again. And we're seeing that in other parts of the world. There are a number of countries that are now beginning to experience healthcare crisis like the way that we saw in Northern Italy and in New York City before. So we have to find a balance and find a way of sustaining that until we have a vaccine.
Great. Thank you very much for joining me again, Dr. Inglesby.
Thanks so much, Josh.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.